Today, in the third part of our series on the M1 Carbine, we are looking at using this rifle in the role of self-defense. And by that I mean just for the average regular person for personal protection in their home or maybe their business. If you missed the first two parts, we covered the background and history of this gun in part one. You might want to go check that out. And then in the second part, we looked at the ballistics of the 30 carbine cartridge. So naturally, a lot of people are now going to be wondering how the M1 carbine stacks up against the other options we have available today for a home defense kind of role. And so we're going to look at the why, the pros and the cons, and then maybe a few things you can do to modify these things to make them a little more suitable for that home defense role. So why would anyone want to rely on an M1 carbine for home defense in the year 2019? Well, we know the cartridge itself is pretty effective. It's a lightweight gun with very light recoil. It's easy to shoot, really easy to teach someone how to use, even if they're not really a shooting enthusiast. So in that respect, it checks a lot of the boxes that we look for in a good, well-rounded home defense gun. But an AR-15 also checks all of those same boxes and then some. It is more ergonomic than the M1 carbine. It's got better ammunition that's also more affordable. It's way easier to accessorize. It's more reliable. It's more durable. And it's not going to really cost any more than an M1 carbine either. So it doesn't really seem to make a whole lot of sense to rely on a 75-year-old piece of history to defend yourself when you've got a much more capable weapon readily available. However, there are a lot of good reasons one might want to use an M1 carbine for self-defense. The first is that for a lot of people, self-defense is not the primary reason for owning the gun. They like the history of the M1 carbine. They enjoy shooting it because it's just a lot of fun to shoot at the range. They feel competent and confident with it. You know, not everyone wants to own a different gun for every purpose that they might need a gun for. So for a lot of people, it's just a fun gun, and hey, why not have it in the closet just in case? I would not criticize anyone for making that decision as long as they knew the gun was reliable and they knew how to use it competently. There are some more practical reasons for relying on an M1 carbine. One of them is that for a lot of people, their local range might not allow them to fire real rifle cartridges like the 223 or 556 out of an AR-15, but they might allow an M1 carbine since its ballistics are kind of closer to a pistol cartridge. And a little added bonus, you still get a cartridge that is just a little more effective than the average pistol cartridge. So it's almost rifle ballistics with a carbine that is a little more indoor range friendly. That's a big advantage for a lot of people if they've only got one place to practice in their town. That's becoming more and more common. Outdoor ranges are just not accessible for a lot of people. So hey, M1 carbine's indoor range friendly if that is your only choice. I'm going to put this thing down now because I'm tired of holding it. See if I can balance it like that. Nope. Probably the most compelling reason to consider an M1 carbine is that in a lot of places in this country, an AR-15 is not legal where an M1 carbine is. Now, in some places, they're both illegal. I know New Jersey has specifically outlawed the M1 carbine, which is un-American and really unfortunate. But if you live in one of those states where you can get an M1 carbine, but you can't get an AR-15, it is a viable option. Another thing that's easy to overlook is that in some places, an AR-15 might technically be legal, but you have to consider how it's going to be perceived. Even if you have a completely justified self-defense shooting, you have to consider there's going to be law enforcement responding. There's going to be a DA who's looking at that case. If it ends up going to trial, there's going to be a jury that's considering it. If you live in an area where people are really likely to look at an AR-15 and just automatically assume you're the bad guy, well, it might work in your favor to have used a gun that's got a traditional looking wood stock that was a rifle that your granddaddy carried in the good war. It just, in some cases, might give you a little bit of an edge from a public relations standpoint. I'm not saying that's a good thing or that it should be that way, but that's just reality in a lot of places. Of course, there are no guarantees, but it's a little harder to vilify a gun like the M1 carbine than a modern evil black rifle. There are plenty of other alternatives to an AR. One that a lot of people have mentioned already is the Ruger Mini 14. Now, I am not a huge fan of the Mini 14. I'm not going to go into a whole lot of detail. Greg Elifritz has a really great article on his blog that I will link to. He kind of goes through each of the points I would probably mention about the shortcomings of the Mini 14. It's not to say the M1 Carbine doesn't have its own problems, and a lot of them are the same problems, but the Mini 14 just, it doesn't have the history or the charm of the M1 Carbine, but you've got all of these issues that make it what I think is an inferior rifle. Now, having said that, I am probably a little biased. I owned a Mini 14 and had a bad experience. If you've got one that works, I'm sure it's a fine choice for home defense. If you're just looking for a gun that is not an AR-15, not a modern looking rifle that's easy to use and easy to teach a beginner to use, I would suggest, instead of the M1 Carbine, or the Mini 14, the Ruger PC Carbine. This is a 9mm carbine that takes Glock magazines. It's about $500. It's pretty good to go right out of the box. You don't have to do a whole lot with it. It's not as fun as an M1 Carbine, but it's got a lot of those same features. It's low recoil. It's fairly lightweight. It's got a nice set of ghost ring sights on it. It's ready to take optics if you want to put optics on it. And, you know, just for a, here's a home defense gun that's cheap and easy to use, I would go with something like this. If the history thing is not important to you, if you're not really wanting to shell out the money required for a reliable M1 carbine, look into the Ruger PC carbine. Okay, so if you have decided the M1 carbine is your go-to home defense gun, there's a few things you can do to kind of bring it up to date a little bit. Now, the biggest one, I think, is the addition of a Picatinny rail. I'll get to that in just a minute. There are a couple of other things I've got on here. First is this sling. Now, I'm kind of neutral on the issue of slings on home defense guns. I don't think they're essential by any means, but some people really like them. If you do want a sling on your home defense gun, you probably want a modern sling like this VTAC sling. The GI sling is really just a canvas carry strap. It's fine for putting the gun around your shoulder and walking around with it, but for home defense, if you like having a sling, it's so you can go hands-free. And a modern sling like this one lets you still shoot the gun. You can shoulder the gun with the sling on, and then if you need to use your hands for something else, you just grab the quick adjustment thing, and now I can do whatever I need to do without putting the gun down on the ground. So as you can see, there's no problem attaching a modern sling to the M1 carbine. You just use the attachment points that the gun already has, the sling swivel here on the barrel band, and then the sling and oiler slot in the stock. I've also got back here a stock pouch. Now this one is from Olongapo Outfitters. There are a ton of GI type stock pouches out there, originals and reproductions. They are canvas and they're fine for just keeping a couple of magazines on the gun. But this one is a more modern material. It's some kind of nylon. It's not gonna hold moisture as much as the canvas. It'll probably last a little bit longer. Now this is definitely not necessary for a home defense gun. It's just kind of a nice thing to have. I like having a stock pouch on a gun because if I take the gun to the range and I forget to pack magazines in my range bag, I know I've at least got the two mags that are on the buttstock. Like the GI mag pouches, this one holds two 15-round magazines. It's got a Velcro closure instead of the snap. Again, not really a home defense specific accessory. Really, it's just something I thought was cool, and I think Olongapo Outfitters makes good stuff. They also make belt pouches for M1 carbine magazines, and I think a chest rig too. So if you have some use for that, you can find them from them. Now the optics rail, a lot of people are gonna hate this because it makes the rifle look different. It takes away that traditional look and feel. Some people are gonna call it blasphemy. That's fine, I get it. If you wanna keep your rifle original, by all means, do it. But for a rifle that's already really handy and really shootable, I think this enhances the utility of it. It doesn't make any permanent modifications to the gun. It just replaces the top part of the forend. This rail is from Ultimac. They've been making these for several years. By all accounts, it's a quality piece of hardware. I certainly haven't had any problems with this one. Now, I've just got a little Trigicon RMR on here, but you could also, especially for home defense, attach an offset light mount. I would consider that a pretty important addition if you are going to use this for your home, because no matter what rifle you're using or firearm period, you need to have a way to positively identify your target. Now, some people have their home set up so that they just have a certain light that they leave on in their house. That's fine too. Whatever the case is, you want to make sure you're not just shooting at shapes in the dark. You have to be able to see your target before you shoot at it. Rule four, right? Now the optic, some people aren't on board with those, but if you've used red dots extensively, then I don't have to tell you just how much utility they add to a long gun. It just makes it way easier to shoot quickly and accurately, especially on up close targets. Just for fun, I did a few drills anyway. I just made up a quick little drill. It was like a double failure drill. So body, body, head on one target, then body, body, head on another target. I was on average 30% faster with the optic than with the iron sights. Then as it got darker and the lighting conditions were actually more like they'd probably be inside my house at twilight or nighttime, the optic was actually twice as fast, and I almost got no misses with the optic, where I was throwing shots every once in a while when I couldn't find the front sight through the peep. If you don't like putting an optic on this thing, don't want to spoil the looks of it, one option I think could work is a ghost ring sight. I think this gun is just begging for it. It seems like a prime candidate for it. I haven't seen where anyone has actually done it. I don't know that you can buy a ghost ring sight ready to go for the M1 carbine. You could just drill out the rear aperture. Unfortunately, you can't just remove the aperture itself from this assembly. The whole assembly kind of stays together as one unit, so you'd have to replace the whole unit if you didn't want to modify your original rear sight. But I don't see any reason why it wouldn't work. If one of you guys has tried that, or if you want to try it and let me know how it goes, I would love to hear how it worked out for you, because I think it would be great for up close shooting. You could acquire that front sight way quicker through a larger aperture, and you still wouldn't lose much accuracy out to about 100 yards or so. Now, before you start messing with the sights or decide to put optics on an M1 carbine to make it a better self-defense gun, there's something else you should probably pay more attention to, and that is reliability. Reliability should be a top priority for any self-defense gun, and it's also not something that the M1 carbine is known for. Fortunately, there are some things you can do to get an M1 carbine to run relatively trouble-free, but I've talked enough for today, so I think we're going to stretch this series out into four parts. I'm going to address reliability in the next part, so be looking out for that. Of course, in the meantime, you can buy all the ammo you would ever need with lightning fast shipping from us at LuckyGunner.com.